your entertainment and education every Thursday, the first Thursday of every month. I would like to introduce tonight one of my co-hosts, Jack Rogers from the North Metro Tea Party. And one of the other organizers of this tea party is here. His name is David Benner. We just call him Benner. And he's going to give you a little lesson on the misnomers of the Constitution in a little bit. But let me go through real quick what tonight's events look like. At 6 to 7 o'clock every meeting that we have will be a kind of casual social hour. Towards the last half of that hour, we want to do something called 1 Minute Moments. We've adopted this from the North Metro Tea Party. That's basically an open mic. Anyone can come up, they can promote themselves. If they're running for office, their business, they can promote a Tea Party-oriented cause, try to convince you to come out to the BPOU and be part of the political process. If you're a legislator here in the audience, you might want to introduce yourself during that period of time. At 7 o'clock, we will get this thing kicked off with a Pledge of Allegiance, because we love this wonderful country. Yeah. Yes, we do. And then I want to do a 5 to 10 minute thing each month on the national debt and economics here at the federal level. And my friend Benner wants to do a 5 to 10 minute thing each month about American history and the Constitution. So that's your education. But right after your education, because education can be kind of boring, we're going to keep it real short. We're going to go right into political entertainment, and I'm not going to give it away yet, but you're going to have some fun, and there will be prizes too, by the way. At 7:40, this is actually the district, the House district of Representative Kathy Lohmer, and we've invited her to come here and speak tonight, so we'll have the actual Tea Party-oriented legislator here. And then at 8 o'clock is the main show. That is a wonderful Tea Party legislator. He actually sits on the Public Safety Committee in the House. And his name is Representative Jim Neuberger, and he's going to talk about the gun debate at the Capitol. And at 8:30, we are usually going to go into a portion called What's Hot on YouTube. If you haven't been watching YouTube or don't know what YouTube is, we're going to teach you what it is, figure out how you can learn from YouTube, this wonderful resource, and we're going to go through some of the greatest trending videos of the last month. We might have a problem with that, though. We've had just about everything go wrong as far as audio goes. So I can't make promises it's going to work today, but we're going to do our best. I also would like to thank the Machine Shed for letting us use this space free of charge. They put together a wonderful menu for us. I was told by both Kurt Bills and Jason Lewis, who I invited to this first meeting, and I was told, well, I'd love to make it, Jake, but, you know, there's this Lincoln-Reagan dinner at the Elephant Club. I said, well, we got a better dinner. We got the Jefferson Coolidge dinner. Yeah. I personally, as a Tea Party guy, tie my ideology to Jefferson more than Lincoln. And in the 20th century, Reagan was a good president, but I don't think there was a better one than Calvin Coolidge. So we have a special Jefferson Coolidge dinner tonight. We have prime rib leading off the menu. A shed burger, it's a half-pound burger, and I believe if you want to put another $2 on there, they can make it a full pound. Classic fried chicken, there's a two-piece dinner I put on there, but I think for another couple bucks, we'll throw in another two pieces of chicken for you. We have the Plowman's Meatloaf, country fried steak, and chicken. You get to pick one of the two. And then we also have a Caesar salad. So I hope you guys have a good time. Feel free to drink, give these guys some business, and I'm going to turn over to Jack Rogers because he does an even better job introducing the wait staff in the venue here.
Thank you. Give Jake and Benner a big hand. They started talking several months ago. We started meeting, in fact, after the North Metro Tea Party meetings, we would stop and meet. But I've got to settle two things before we start. The first thing is, in that walk, I was asked 5 times, what happened to the blue fox? The people are okay? They sold the blue fox. The owner, Tom, sold the blue fox. And we've been in communication with Kim and the employees. But the North Metro is not going anyplace. We're just relocating. And I talked to Kim twice today. And yes, it's very emotional. So the concern shall not be where we move at this time. The concern is that those people that were part of the North Metro Tea Party month after month that you keep them in your prayers right now. God is going to land us someplace that we need to be. So we're going forward, okay? And we're going to celebrate this happening tonight. The east side. You know, we're almost totally surrounding the metro, and we're going to move in now on them. Pretty soon we'll have a dead center St. Paul Tea Party and a dead center Minneapolis Tea Party. One will be called... We're going to work with the gangbangers in each one of those cities. I didn't write that. I don't know. That just popped into my head. But I want you all to think of, what was your first experience with a tea party?
This
right here tonight? Oh, you guys aren't thinking open enough.
Phoenix, Arizona.
How many people here? By the way, did you see the St. Paul Pioneer Press about this tea party coming out with young people?
Yes.
Did you see that? I had to call Jake and say, what's with that? And so I just asked Benner, I said, where are all the young people? He said, Nick's meeting.
You don't get the paper.
So don't let that stop you from coming here. But any of you here have children? Raise your hands. Okay. I have two daughters. My first experience with a tea party is what? A tea party with little cups, right? Yeah, any of you have that with your daughters? Nobody? Right there, okay? I was home with my oldest daughter, and she was about 5. My youngest daughter and my wife are away. So my oldest daughter sets up her little tea party, and I'm on my computer, laptop, sitting there, kind of keeping an eye on her. And she came over and said, Daddy, you want to try my tea? And I go, like a good dad, sip. Oh, that's wonderful. And it's just water, right? So this goes on about 4 or 5 times. And my wife comes home. And I said, watch this. And so my oldest daughter goes and gets the tea, brings it over. Oh, Daddy, I got a brand new batch. Do you want to try the tea? And I go, well, of course, Naja, well. And I drink the tea. My wife buckles over in laughter. And I said, I thought it was cute too. Isn't that wonderful? And she goes, do you have any idea where a 5-year-old can access water at her height? My first experience with a tea party. And if none of you have been there, at least you've been at close where they go to the dog dish. Anyway, it is a wonderful, exciting thing to see this. This is truly pure grassroots. This is really people standing up and saying, enough is enough. We're going to band together. We're going to start understanding stuff, learning stuff, etc. One of the things that I think there were 5 of us last night that were working together, we're going to take some of the pieces of each one of the meetings and move them to other tea parties so they get that same information. So it spreads and really works. Well, let's start, and we did give Jake copyright approval to use the North Metro Tea Party 1-Minute Moments, which came about by accident, but we loved it, and became a very exciting part. So,
I'm a little out of, I should have reviewed my notes here. I guess I have another slide before we get to 1-Minute Moments.
Way to go, Jake.
I was told... I need to show a slide saying who we are as a tea party and how we came about. So I'm going to cover the how we came about, and then Jack's going to cover who we are and what we believe in our 3 core principles. This tea party actually started with a couple like-minded individuals enjoying a fine glass of whiskey one night, just the way this country was founded. And we decided we need to do something here, get involved in the process. Now, I'm involved politically. A lot of you that are in the GOP probably see me around. The other two weren't. And the traditional methods weren't really appealing to him. So what we said is, let's do this tea party and let's see how that goes. So that's how we got started. But the more important thing is, what are our principles? And Jack does a good job explaining that.
You got the projector? Okay, give me the slides. The tea party, especially the Tea Party Patriots, represent 3 core values. Many of you who have come month after month to many different tea parties knows the first one is what? Free markets. That doesn't mean you go in and get vegetables for free. That means every person that wishes to risk their resources to build a business or an opportunity should have that opportunity and should be able to engage in free capitalism without intervention by the government. All right, next. Fiscal responsibility. This one, I mean, every time you turn on the radio, 90% of what you hear is about irresponsibility. How is that possible? Think for a minute of people at work, at a person in your church, somebody else in a Boy Scout or Girl Scout troop you work with. Do you ever see any of them just spending money and not at some point in time becoming responsible to take care of what they spent? No. Who is it that's selling all of America on the lack of fiscal responsibility? I don't meet those people. I try sometimes because I engage people wherever I go. That's pretty scary, isn't it? Such a common sense, simple thing. But we believe in fiscal responsibility. Balancing your checkbook each month and expecting those that we elect to live with that value. The next one. You missed one.
No, that's
all. Individualism. It is.
Change it a little bit in the North Metro, but same principle.
Same principle. Individualism. We got to get this right. We got to put them side by side. Principles of the founding fathers. Absolutely. Representing such clear, simple values that they can be transparent to anything you hold up and compare to it. And if you hold up a bill, a movement, or whatever, and if it doesn't pass the test of those three simple core values, you got a problem, don't you? All righty. Next. It's his first night. Give him a break.
Well, it's part me learning how to use this Mac I have. And some of you know me. I've been using that joke now for a month, so I'm not going to be able to use it much longer. But, hey, Twitterers, or tweeters, however you put it, get out your phone and use the hashtag EastMetroTeaParty. Get this thing trending. We want to make sure that the media covers how awesome of an event we have tonight. We also have a Facebook account for you guys that are on Facebook. You just put up in the search menu East Metro Tea Party and you will see exactly who we are, and I would recommend liking our page. All right, I think we're going right into the 1 minute moments. Jack, and I think we've got a couple people that already want to speak.
You know who they are? Who are they? Who wanted to speak at the 1 minute moments?
Oh, there we go. We got Janice Quinlan.
Come on up. Both of you. Now don't forget, say your name. And at 59 seconds, I'll give you a little kick in the fanny, okay?
Okay. My name is Cedric Schofield, and I'm a volunteer coordinator for the National Rifle Association. And my task is to help volunteers like you in your support of NRA legislative policy. Now, right now, we could use your help on some things. One, to be a Frontlines volunteer with us, and I have some cards here, and if you just sign up on a Frontlines volunteer, it's basically a matter of being on my email list to send you an occasional email on things that will be helpful to you in your activism. The other thing is kind of organizing a campaign to kind of get after our legislators in Minnesota, and we're working on several ideas. One is to just kind of embarrass about how we have enough laws already. There's a lot of people in Minnesota don't know that we have a lot more gun laws than a lot of other states. There are 30-some states that do not have a permit to purchase background check like we do. We all have the National Instant Check System, but we're one of a few states, in addition to that, we have a permit to purchase background check. We don't need it. Those other states are just as safe as we are, so they're kind of punishing us with too many laws there already. Another idea to get on legislators with is there are 12,000 or 20,000 gun laws already, both state and national, and there's enough laws to prosecute anybody that comes close to doing anything wrong with a gun already, so we don't really need any more. Now, in Minnesota, in November of last year, the House Research Group did a study on gun laws, and they produced a book, a guideline. Firearms in Minnesota, something like that, a guide for legislators. It's 113 pages long. Now, it takes that long to explain it. We've got enough gun laws already. So again, I'd like anyone that is interested to see me and fill out one of these little cards, just give me your email address, and it won't be published or used for any other purpose. Second thing I'd like to talk to you about just briefly is on the 16th of this month, a week from Thursday, we're having our first ever Capital City Friends of the NRA banquet. And if you'd like to attend that, I have some tickets here for you. And if you reserve a ticket by tomorrow, you'll be in an early bird drawing for a Smith & Wesson PT-7. It's a 40 caliber slim. It's a carry piece. Thank you.
Give him a hand. Last night when we were meeting, the plan is if this room got too full, we have another room to back this room up. All right, so if we tell you you got to pick up your plates and move, just ignore it. We'll make those people way in the back who just got here come way to the front. So if you want to come up, we got places up here. Also, if you are going to speak or say something, just come up and get in line up here, okay? By the way, the NRA is active down in the Capitol. If you're down there, they are working hard. And so please continue to influence them as well. All right, come on up, Janet.
Say who you are.
Hello, my name's Janice Quinlan. I ran for Senate in District 54 this past year, and I lost, unfortunately. Haven't decided for sure if I'm going to run again, but I am very involved. I'm assistant chair in our BPOU. And one thing that I had started, a lot of you are probably Glenn Beck fans, and right now I'm a licensed teacher. And although I sell real estate and I don't officially teach, I started actually the end of February to substitute about once or twice a week to see what's going on in the schools, and it's amazing. It's very interesting. So with that, I'm kind of, want to close the doors, be a spy just to check out what's going on in schools. I started a Facebook page called Minnesota's Against Common Core, and so I would invite anybody to join that page. Just started it, so the information is just starting to pile in right now. But it's really important right now that we get going on educating ourselves about Common Core and preventing it from going any further in our school districts, because it's pretty much a poison and we need to stop it. It's very important. And my name is Janice Quinlan, and if anybody needs to get a hold of me, you can find me on either Twitter or Facebook, and I appreciate your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Janice. Janice, you've got to coordinate with Kurt, because Price and Burbeck are working on some educational finds that are pretty nasty, and they can use any investigation information you have. So, next, Mandy, come on up. Tell them who you are.
Thanks, everybody, for being here tonight. My name is Mandy Benz. Some of you may know me from running for House of Representatives in District 37A, which is out in Coon Rapids, Blaine Spring Lake Park. My connection that I have here is I used to work as the legislative assistant for Senator Ted Lilly, who had this district, and it's tough. I miss it here very much. It's hard not having him in office. I see so many people from his district here tonight, and thank you for staying active. Thank you for participating and helping the last elections. Unfortunately, both the senator and myself lost our elections, so here we are, and I'm so glad that we have a Tea Party, a new Tea Party to go for. It means people are very concerned, and we're still looking to go forward in the state of Minnesota. So a couple things I want to announce. I plan on running for office again, and I know what it looks like out there. It's going to be tough, and all the candidates need to be raising money. I know we just got over with the election. I know everyone got bothered by donations, but it's if you can donate $10 now to candidates that you support, whether they're in your district or not, we need to find those that are principled, that really have true grit, that they're instinctively conservative to run, because when they get down there at the Capitol, whether they're in your district or not, they're gonna create legislation that's gonna affect the entire state. Look at the exchange, look at the gun laws, et cetera. They affect all of us. So I'm asking for your support. If you're willing to open your pocketbooks and donate, I would love that. I am trying to get a website up and going, and it costs $200, and it's going to include some data mining in that, so I can start looking at my district and seeing how I can target market and really, really get a grasp on this election. And we really need to crush the Democrats this next time around. So, Number two, one of the other things that I partake in, I'm a co-chair for Draft Emmer 2014. So I think Emmer is one of the principal conservatives we have left in the state of Minnesota. There's others out there like him. But those that are, we need to maintain and keep them going. So we're not specifying that Emmer's going to run for governor or Senate or who knows what else will open up. So if you believe that Tom still has, you know, a good principal base, and thanks to Dayton Alita Messenger, he is a household name now. And he came very close to winning last time, which tells me I think he can really win a second time around, no matter what position we put him in. So that's the other thing. Number three, since I lost my election and Senator Lilly lost his election, that also led to me losing my job down at the Capitol. And as you know, the climate in the state of Minnesota for job searching is really tough. And it's been 3 months. I've been unsuccessful finding employment. I would like to homeschool my son because I do see what's going on in the public schools, and it's very, very concerning. But it's tough to make it on one income. Okay? So one of the things I looked at is, how can I run a business from my own home? I mean, we're Republicans, so we stand for free market enterprise. We're do-it-yourself people. We believe we have better ideas and we can get things done better ourselves in our home versus the government, right? So one of the things that I recently signed on to is become a Mary Kay consultant. And now selling a tube of lipstick, right? Well, hell, I went door knocking every single door in my district without anything to sell, and I did it for free. So what was I thinking? So here, it's not about selling makeup. It's about empowering ourselves to be able to run our own business. I believe everybody should have a home-based business just for the tax write-offs. I mean, that's utilized the system to our benefit, right? It's there. Let's do it. So if anybody has any thought or interest into talking to me, or Mary Amla does home-based businesses too, I suggest you talk to Mary Amla and just see what it takes to get going. It doesn't have to be Mary Kay. It doesn't have to be what Mary's doing, but just to get an idea of what it takes to start one in your own home. It's not that hard. It gives us the flexibility to homeschool our kids, to make the income that we deserve. And in Mary Kay, you do earn a free car, and it's not always a pink Cadillac, just so you know. It's a Chevy Malibu, and it's free, and the company pays for your insurance. They also are based out of Dallas, Texas. Hello, the state that empowers more jobs than any other state in the U.S. Not only that, the company pays, they get the car, and you get your own insurance. Oh, Jack's kicking me off here because we've got a little bit of line that's grown. So thank you for your time. If you have any questions or anything, let me know, and thanks for being here.
Bruce, next person up is one of the coordinators of North Metro Tea Party. Give him a big hand.
I'll try and be brief. Mandy took up most of my time, but I love you, Mandy. My name is Bruce Miller. I am one of the coordinators with North Metro, so I want to say thank you very much for showing up tonight. I don't think I'll be down here a whole lot. I'm also a council member up in Champlin, Minnesota. That's at the other end of the state. But it's a nice drive down here. I really am excited to see this going on tonight. But one of the things, one of the founders of the North Metro Tea Party is having a birthday today. Mary Amla, if you'd please stand up. She's 29 today. And if you don't mind, we'd like to sing happy birthday to you. So, ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mary. Happy birthday to you. Thank you. That's it.
And there's cake.
There's cake. Come on up. Tell us your name. And I am watching the times.
Okay. My name is Jim Brunsgard, and I'm a retired Navy veteran serving the Iraqi War. I'm also part of the 56 Club, and I sang happy birthday to Mary on Tuesday. So this is twice I've sang happy birthday to her. But after this election, I just got, you know, I was basically in depression after what happened with the bomb. And I'm sure a lot of people felt depression. But I just said, I got to do something with this. And I said, I'm a third generation Navy man. My father and grandfather served in World War I and World War II. And like I said, I'm trying to carry forward the tradition. And I started a got a group going as far as decided to have a Patriots Day rally, like they have in Lexington Concord every year. At the state capitol, everything's arranged. Got the speakers arranged. I got the flyers right here so I can hand those out. I'm going to be one of the speakers toward the end. And I got some really good speakers. Tony Cornish is going to be speaking. And also got, I don't know if you know Scott Smart, who runs Smart Security down in Hastings. It's a gun shop down there. He's also a retired Navy Senior Chief, Petty Officer. And also, too, we have a constitutional pastor, which is Arthur Lee Parks. He runs a church over in Somerset. And we also have Mitch Berg, AM 1280. He's going to be there as well. So it's going to be Mitch Berg. Okay. But anyway, the event is going to be on 15th of April, Tax Day, at 5 p.m. in the afternoon. I know it's a lot to ask as far as some folks, you know, it's going to have to get off early work. But as you say, it's at the state capitol in front. We got a band also coming. It's the, let me see here. I don't have my glasses on me, but it's Luke Turner, which is a basically a constitutional pastor I know. He knows the guy, and he really does some really good music. And he's going to be doing some music, and also the national anthem, too. But I appreciate it if you guys show up, and I'm going to, you know, I've got 10 posters right here, flyers right here, so if you'd like to post them someplace, that would be great. Help spread out the word. And I'm going to post them as much as I can. I've been putting them on the different websites as far as, you know, the Tea Party Lobby. I've been putting on the, you know, as far as the GoCrow page. And like I said, I definitely would appreciate your help and as far as getting the word out about this event and seeing a lot of Patriots there.
Thank you. I like the military guys. I never was in the military, but Jake told me last night when I said, what did you learn in the military? And he said, if the enemy is in range, so are you. That's wisdom. Introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Elise Gardner. I'm just going to talk for a minute for the Washington County Republicans. I'm the president of another great conservative organization here in the county. We meet once a month, the second Tuesday of every month. Our upcoming meeting, or second Saturday of every month. Oh my goodness. Our upcoming meeting will be Saturday, April 13th. We've got a great one lined up here. Our guest speaker will be Senator Karin Housley. Legislative updates also from Representative Bob Detmer, Andrea Kiefer, Kathy Lohmer, and Matt Dean. So if you live in the area, it's really great to get to know your representatives and really have a talk with them, what you're expecting from the government. You know, give them a little encouragement since they're having a hard time there. And come meet us. And Saturday, May will also be our meeting. And we're going to have Aaron House speaking on social media and politics. So we've got great meetings lined up. And you can visit us online at WCRMN.com. And we're also on Facebook and Twitter.
Where do you meet?
Lake Elmo Inn. Lake Elmo.
Okay. Next.
Hi, everyone. I'm Amy Williams. I am a councilwoman for the city of Lakeland. I'm also a BPOU chair for Senate District 39 and the deputy chair for CD4. I'm up here to speak to you tonight just to raise awareness for our BPOU full committee meeting that's coming up on Thursday, April 18th. It's going to be at Stillwater Township Town Hall. It's open to anyone who wants to attend, so even if you're not a resident of Senate District 39, if you want to come and be a part of a really dynamic, newly organizing BPOU, we'd love to have you there. We've planned some great events for the coming year. We have a Republican family potluck picnic that we do in the summer. We had some fantastic turnout for that picnic last year. We're hoping to have a lot of people to come out and have a good time, and the organization and planning for those events starts in 2 weeks. So if you'd like to come out and be a part of something really dynamic and interesting, we would love to have you there. We're on Facebook at MNGOPSD39, and we also have a website at the same address, MNGOPSD39. Otherwise, you can always contact me directly, Amy Williams. Thanks.
Thank you. How's the food, by the way?
Excellent.
I don't know all the waitresses' names here yet, so make sure you treat them like family, tip them well. In fact, you know what they're doing, don't you? Did you read the headline this morning that average Americans' weight have gone up? The weight has gone up for average Americans. That means I finally hit my goal this year. So eat up. Know you're going to hit your goal, okay?
Hello, my name's Julie Zappa. I think we have to do more to protect the Second Amendment than just talk about it. So what I'm trying to do is I had cups made that say, another good guy with a gun. And I also have gals, because at the last meeting I sold my cups, all the women wanted to know where the another good gal with a gun cups are. I've got them now. For Tea Party, I sell them $6 a piece, and a dollar of each cup goes to the NRA. And it's a good way to voice your opinion. Sometimes it seems like people don't want to speak up and say they're gun owners, so it's another way to do it. Maybe not take it to work, but take it somewhere. And there's a website, another, maybe to school. Give it to the principal for a gift, a goodbye gift. And it's anothergoodguywithagun.com. We have a website, too. So I hope you stop by the table over here and pick a couple up.
Thank you. Thank you. Come on up, people back. We still got a nice full table back here for you. Just feel free to come on up. All righty? By the way, I got to comment on the young crowd again, Jake. These are my age people. See, we are so old. When you went to the doctor and they discovered a disease, they named them after us.
I think you're offending some of these people. I've seen a lot of young people out here, so I don't know what you're talking about, Jack.
Oh, okay.
But the younger crowds, they like to eat dinner a little later, so just let it go a little bit longer.
Come on.
Well, I kind of resent all this talk about age because to a lot of people, I look, you know, pretty whatever, but whatsoever. I'm trying to get out of the habit of saying whatever. Too many of my friends say it drives me nuts. Whatever, 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 whatever. But my name is Bob Tatro, and my main reason for standing in front of you is to get you folks involved in this anti-light rail fight.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, right here in Woodbury, the Gateway Corridor, this insidious attack, it's like, I was thinking it's like Sherman's March to the Sea because it's going to destroy everything in its path. And we got to get rid of it. Yeah, it's going to hop over so many. You know, I was talking to one of the people who's really involved with this, and I was saying to this person, I'm not going to say male or female because I don't want to identify him too much, but this person's really involved. I said, have you driven this route? No. Well, I said, I've driven it a couple times in the past week, and my gosh. These houses, I can see them all destroyed. These businesses, I can see them all destroyed. And then to jump over all these 61 and McKnight and all the freeways, no, it's not worth it. It's going to destroy folks' lives. And, you know, a few more express buses and a few more places, park and ride with, you know, elevated parking spaces is what will do it. So what I'm asking is if you have any inclinations whatsoever, please come and help me, Bob Tatro. Please come and help Steve Ellenwood, my good partner. We've been going down to the Capitol. We've been talking to people. We've been passing out flyers. And get involved in this. If you see a chance to write a letter, express your opinion. We've got to stop this. It's a $400 million monstrosity. Thank you.
Amen. Mitch Berg, come on up.
Just $400 million? Wow, where did you luck out? Hi, I'm Mitch Berg. And no diseases named after me yet, but I am a Mary Kay consultant. See me after the show. I'm here for two things, really. I finally joined the NRA this year after holding on for many, many years, but more the merrier. But while you're doing that, I'm going to urge you to join the Gun Owners Civil Rights Alliance as well. They've been doing the heavy lifting year in, year out for the last 15 years when I first joined up. If you haven't gone out to GOCRA, that's GOCRA.org, make sure you do. Because they've been doing a lot of the heavy lifting in between all the work the NRA has done for gun rights here in Minnesota. The other thing I want to bring up is I'm a vice chair of CD4 Republican Party, one of those gangbangers who was mentioned early here, apparently. Word. And what I want to do is ask you, if you're from St. Paul, if you know someone from St. Paul, you got kids in St. Paul. We got something we're doing on the fourth CD that we want to try and really push this next year here. April and October is when the district councils have their elections. Now, if you know what the district councils are, consider yourselves lucky. They're basically a fourth tier of government in St. Paul that spends a lot of the community planning money, which means a lot of money gets spent by these people. So what we want to do is, nice thing about it is nobody knows or cares about them. So if you get a bunch of Republican friends, either you, St. Paul residents, or people who do business in St. Paul also welcome to run for most of these community councils. And just go in there, bring some friends, get yourself elected. Really, it is a great way to influence the political system on the cheap and do what the DFL's been doing in St. Paul for the last 40 years. Use these community councils as training grounds for new politicians and to help people in this city learn that Republicans don't have and conservatives and Tea Partiers don't have horns growing out their heads and aren't all the things they've been told about us. So if you're from St. Paul, you know someone, you got kids, family, you own a business in St. Paul, think about it. Think about it hard. Contact me. Thanks. See ya.
Thanks, man. He is one of the most enjoyable people to listen to. Now, can I see the hands of veterans? All right, keep them up for a minute. Can I have a veteran who is, just wait. Don't get ahead of me. Keep your hands up. Can I have a veteran come up and lead in the Pledge of Allegiance? And as he's coming up, and I want somebody that hasn't done this publicly before since, can I see hands? Your closest. Now give all the vets a big hand of appreciation. Let us know your name and what branch you serve.
There you go.
Kevin Magnuson, United States Army.
Okay.
First Gulf War.
Right there.
All right. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, vets. Jake, it's to you.
Well, thank you very much, Jack. We're going to move right along with the main show. If you have another one-minute moment, we might have some trouble with the YouTube portion of the evening with the audio, so we'll stick that in at the end. Now, I see a lot of people are out of this room. They're hanging around in the very, very busy-looking hallway. We do have some room up here at this table, up there by my friend Eric, and right over here, so come up here and get a seat. And we promise not to bite. I have a portion that I'm going to bring up every month. It's called An Update on the National Debt. But before I do that, I would like to introduce to you guys a very good friend of mine. His name is Tony Hernandez. He was our congressional candidate in CD4. Tony, tell the crowd what you're up to these days.
Well, I guess first I just want to say there are some young people in this crowd that I see. Representative Mary Franson right here, strong young leader of the Republican Party. I just want to give her recognition. And yeah, so Jake and I, we actually have our own television show. So after the ashes were done burning after the 2012 election, I still felt, and I still do to this day, feel a dying passion and love for our country. And I'm willing to continue to fight, do whatever it takes to restore the founding principles of this great country and to really build this idea of a better America in our future. So Jake and I and Dallas and some other people, we decided that we're going to do our own television show. And we ingeniously named it the Tony Hernandez Show. But we air every Saturday. It's in Washington County and Ramsey County on SCC television, and then it plays in St. Paul as well. And we just talk about issues, federal finances, local issues like the stadium, and we try to mix in sports and stuff like that too. So I know Leona, she's working right now. She's a pediatric ICU nurse, but she definitely says hello. And we have great news. We're expecting a baby on September 1st. So. Yeah, really, really excited about becoming a father. And when I cuddle with Leona at night, I actually put my hand on her belly, and I can feel the tiny little baby kind of moving around.
And where are we having?
We don't know. We're gonna wait. But back to holding the baby, and I can feel the little baby moving around in my palm, and there's no doubt in my mind that is an American. And as an American, deserves every right that you and I deserve, right to life, free speech, right to this great country, due process, all the protections of the Constitution, the Second Amendment, right to bear arms, liberty. So, but she definitely sends her hello. And lastly, I just want to say we did go to a Woodbury town hall, and it was Andrea Kiefer, Representative Andrea Kiefer hosted it. And Betty McCollum was there, Joanne Ward was there, and who's the state senator? Ken. And I just got to say that Andrea Kiefer stood out amongst the group as the true stateswoman. And I believe that conservatives, Tea Partiers, all of us, we need to encourage women to stand up, run for office, people of color, people from diverse backgrounds, because we need to continue to grow this movement. We need to engage our neighbors. We need to talk to our Democrat friends, because there are a lot of shared values that we all have. We just need to reach out and bring people back in. So God bless you. God bless your night, and God bless America. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. It's good to see the press is here. Mike Longacre from the Woodbury Bulletin. That's great to have you here. I see overflow in this room. Is that going to be in the report? All right. I go on Tony's show every Saturday, and I talk about federal economic issues. So I want to do a portion, 5 to 10 minutes, just enough to capture your attention, give you something to be a little bit better in with your debates with people. I own my own financial investment advising firm, so I deal with this stuff on a daily basis. And because we're talking about the reason that a lot of you guys are probably here, and it's very stressful, I bring a stress ball, and if you just throw your hand up, I will throw this to you during my presentation to make sure that you can release all that tension when you see some of these numbers. So this is where we're at. I'm going to do this every month. Where we are at right now with our federal debt, this is the debt that's at the federal government level. We have $16.8 trillion. Anyone ever seen the website U.S. debt? What's that? Oh, you need stress ball. That's right. You got a big beer over there, though. There's your stress ball. Oh, bad aim. That's why I went into finance. I obviously wasn't good enough for sports. Fiscal year 2013, which we just entered the third quarter, the fiscal year starts in October, we are at a projected federal budget deficit of $1.1 trillion, and I'm going to cover that in a little bit. And then we have a monetary base of $3.1 trillion. And other than just a fancy word, what that means is all the cash that's flowing around in our system. To put that in perspective, it was only about a third of that about 6 years ago. So when we talk about our political entertainment, you're going to see something about inflation, and we'll drive home that message there. So what does our federal budget look like? Well, this is our expenditures. We spend $665 billion on defense, which is our largest single budget item in the federal debt or federal budget. However, when you bring the healthcare, Medicare, and Medicaid spending together, that actually represents the biggest joint expenditure, and that's at $816 billion. Social Security, which is actually off a separate budget, but the total of that budget equals $779 billion, and the total interest on the debt projected for fiscal year 2013, which means what we pay on our credit card, is only at a $223 billion. All the rest of the federal spending is just shy of $1.1 trillion. Now, that's just expenditures. That totals $3.6 trillion, and we call that in accounting as outlays. The receipts, the revenue that's brought into the federal government is $2.5 trillion. Now, you don't have to be a math expert to know that there's a little imbalance, right? A balanced budget, those two bars would look the same. Unfortunately, we don't have that. We actually have something called a deficit at $1.1 trillion. Now, I'm guessing the media has told you that, right? But they don't tell you why that's a problem too often. Does anyone know, I want to slide too far. I want to test your knowledge. Does anyone know what happens? How do we finance that $1.1 trillion mismatch? Borrow. I'm hearing a lot of things. Print. Yeah, okay, we do both, actually. We borrow, but that borrowed, some of that borrowed money is printed money. What we do is we take it over to a treasury auction, and this happens actually on a weekly basis, and the treasury acts as a seller of our debt. And so when you have a $1.1 trillion deficit, in that year you have to find some way to have someone finance that $1.1 trillion that lend it to you. Now we have two people that lend to the federal government. We have general investors, that's either domestic or China. We've all heard China owns our debt, right? Well, they own about $1 trillion of our federal debt. The other thing that we do with that money is we have the Federal Reserve come in and buy up some of that debt. Where do they get that money? Money. They have this wonderful digital printing press where they just poof and put it on there for you, and that's what actually puts upward pressure on prices. Well, because of the Fed's interference in the marketplace and us in relation to other countries like the Eurozone, we actually have pretty low interest rates. Here's the four main treasury securities that we use at the federal government. We have treasury bills. That's something that matures under a year term. Currently, there's $1.74 trillion of our debt that's held by the public in those. We have treasury notes. That's anything between 1 and 10 years. And that's the majority of our publicly held debt. That's at $7.42 trillion. We also have something called treasury bonds. Treasury bonds right now, we're only selling 30-year treasury bonds. And the total debt is 1.27. And then we have something called treasury inflation-protected securities. It's something that's priced using the CPI, the Consumer Price Index, and that's just under $1 trillion. Now, why did I show you this slide? Because I want to show you where we're at right now with interest rates. Of all the debt that we have at the federal level held in those four treasury securities, the top line there will show you what the average return or average interest rate is on those securities. The bottom is the most recent. And if you can see, the top is actually pretty low rates, historically speaking, but the bottom is especially low. We're at artificially low rates. In fact, because the tips are measured with the CPI, it's actually a negative rate of return on your bonds. It's pretty funny, right? So, in other words, if you look at that treasury bond, it says 3.19%. That means if you lock up your money 30 years, you lend it to the federal government, you have only 3.19% return every year.
You're an idiot.
Well, come see me. But the big question here, and this is where I'm going to leave you with you tonight, because I don't want to take up much more than 10 minutes in my economic parts, but what happens when that interest rate goes up? Have we ever asked that question? Well, I've done some projections using a couple different scenarios, but this is what happens in this year alone. What matures, what debt at the federal level matures or is new debt? Well, like I said, we have $1.1 trillion of new debt added. That's called the deficit. We also have $1.6 trillion in those treasury bills. Remember, they mature under a year. So those all come due at some point in the year. And we also have $1.2 in treasury notes that will mature this year, and a slight amount in tips. Well, since our federal government never pays down the debt, it hasn't done it since Andrew Jackson, what we do is we pay off our one credit card with another credit card. So when those rates start going up, we have $4 trillion each year that's prone to those new interest rates. And I'm going to give you one of the best case scenarios I run through my research. If those rates go up to 5%, which is actually pretty low, historically speaking, you can see on the left side there is the interest rates double within a three-year span. The defense, I'm using the projections by Barack Obama's budgets, well, his proposal, budget proposals, where we actually cut defense. I haven't seen that. So we put that at $572 billion. I use his figures. Social Security is projected to be just shy of $1 trillion in fiscal year. This would be 2016. And then interest payments would total $490 billion. So that leaves us with $900 billion for the rest of the federal budget. And Medicare and Medicaid would have to be part of that. They that year are going to be over $1 trillion. We have a serious problem, folks, when those interest rates go up. And if we don't allow them to go up, the only other alternative is we keep printing money. And you guys like $4 gasoline? You'll like it when it's $8. So that's all I'm going to talk about tonight. I'll leave you with that. If you're a tweeter, we are using hashtag East Metro Tea Party. If you're on Facebook, find us. Do the search menu for East Metro Tea Party. Like us on Facebook, and you'll stay informed of everything we want to put out in the next month. Now, it's my great privilege to introduce my long friend since college. His name is Benner. We just call him Benner. He's also been known as Metal Dave. He is one of the smartest guys I know on American history, Civil War period, American Revolution, even the World War II period. And he's also almost, judging by some of these politicians, I would say you are an expert on the Constitution. So without further ado, let me bring on my good friend, David Benner.
I ask you to try to take a guy with a tiger arm seriously for at least 10 minutes or so here. So basically, we wanted to try to capture the spirit of both the Boston and Edenton Tea Parties at this event, as they happened in 1773 and 1774 accordingly. I'm happy to be likened to everyone here, if only in that we're all recognized in the same Janet Napolitano memo, which characterizes us as a right-wing extremist group, of course. Right? I actually chuckle when I hear references to such a thing or when groups such as ours are maligned, because I realize that the term loyalist is not only a term to be attributed to those from the era of 1776. So today I realize I'm among adherents to the Constitution, people that believe in it, so I'm not trying to provide remedial education of any type, but I wanted to kind of construct some arguments today on the Constitution so that we can use arguments to defeat those that espouse the living document lie that so permeates our culture. Largely, institutions such as public education and the media will not necessarily help us educating people on these ideas, so I wanted to delve into that. The first thing I wanted to kind of discuss today is general welfare, not only as a theory, but also as how it's used in the Constitution. Now, general welfare clause of the Constitution is used to justify almost any action of the government. They do it all the time. They believe that it is to the general welfare that we expand the welfare state, that we add new government programs and things such as that. Well, it behooves us to learn more about this. First of all, the General Welfare Clause appears in the preamble of the Constitution. We should recognize that the preamble does not enumerate powers to the federal government. It's used as a summative statement which describes the reason for which the rest of the document was written. So we need to recognize that, because if we don't, we allow politicians to exploit that and use it to their gains. Benjamin Franklin said, "Make yourself sheep and the wolves will eat you." So, and that's not kind of an indictment on all the elected representatives here and former representatives. I believe that there are some that believe in the constraints of the Constitution among us, and the Minnesota Constitution. I happen to be a member of the sovereign state of Minnesota. So, one other thing in how it's used in Article 1 in the Constitution. James Madison said in the Federalist Papers, and I like to use Madison because he is the father of the Constitution and the father of the Bill of Rights. James Madison said in Federalist 45 that the powers delegated by the proposed Constitution to the federal government are few and defined. Those that are to remain in the state governments are numerous and indefinite. Madison believed that there is a limited ability of the federal government. He goes on in the same clause in Federalist 45 to say that the taxable attachments to raising taxes and the functions of government are to be war, peace, negotiations, and foreign commerce. It's funny that I don't see the study of why lesbians are so fat, the study of what pig feces in China, or paying for other people's birth controls are in Federalist 45. So that's just what I wanted to mention about the general welfare. Madison believed it was to the general welfare that the government was constrained to limited powers. The next topic I want to touch on is the Commerce Clause and how it's used in the Constitution, right? I already hear some moaning and groaning. This is good stuff. This is powerful stuff we need to kind of elaborate on. So to understand the Commerce Clause, and again, used as justification to regulate states, make impediments to trade, but really, that's another case where it means the exact opposite of what some people purport it to mean. You have to understand the history of the newfound states during the period of the Articles of Confederation. I came up with four situations I would just want to briefly talk about in this. The first is that in that period, in the inner period between the time where the Articles of Confederation were ratified in 1777 and set up a Congress and the ratification of the Constitution in 1788, various things happened amongst the colonies which convinced them to put this in the Constitution. One of them is that state and colonial legislatures actually granted individual debt forgivenesses to certain individuals in those states. This was sometimes done on the criteria of what family they were connected to, which state they had debts in, which businesses they were indebted to. And when this happened, basically there was legalized larceny of those that were able to get out of their debts. I mean, not much has changed, right? I mean, there's legalized larceny all the time as far as I'm concerned. But this was done on the basis of such criteria where sometimes those that owned the debt in other states would claim to their representatives, this is theft, you know, this is larceny, I won't stand for this. And oftentimes the representatives actually agreed. This caused a lot of infighting between the colonies. Another thing is that the states created fiat currencies called bills of credit, at the same time that the Continentals were being printed. This caused rampant inflation in the colonies. It's a wonder that our colonies really survived and our newly founded states survived, because the value of the currencies were completely diminished in that time. The phrase "not worth a continental" comes from that time period. By 1781, the continental was essentially worthless. The winning currency of the day was actually the Spanish coin. The Spanish coins were bullion-based and backed with a worthy commodity that was not fiat currency. So the printing of different types of currencies was now reserved to the federal government. The third thing is counterfeiting by the British. Now, this is something that doesn't get talked about that much, but in that time period of the Revolutionary War, the British enacted large measures to try to counterfeit various forms of US currency, including the Continental. I just wanted to read a Franklin quote from the time, Benjamin Franklin. The artists they employed, and this is referring to the British government, performed so well and immense quantities of these counterfeits, which issued from the British government in New York, were circulated among the inhabitants of all the states before the fraud was detected. This operated significantly in depreciating the whole mass. So there's another situation where the founders were concerned that states that were hostile to each other may try to do these types of counterfeiting measures, and they wanted to allow the Commerce Clause so that the federal government can say, you can't do that. And the last thing is a pretty basic one, but let me just actually mention that states that were classic rivals of each other, here's an example, South Carolina versus Massachusetts. That was a big battle between the two states, and you know, for most of the US experience, those two states stand pretty in pretty stark contrast ideologically. And the last thing is that states created restrictive tariffs with other states as a barrier to trade. So really the Commerce Clause was actually used to remove the corruptibilities and impediments of free trade and free commerce, rather than to do the exact opposite, which some politicians advocate for today. One of the last things I want to touch on is Alexander Hamilton. So here's an argument that I often get, because I love discussing these issues, is, well, Alexander Hamilton, he had a broad interpretation of the Constitution, right? Well, yeah, he did at some points in his life, but I think that actually sheds more light on who Alexander Hamilton was than the rest of the founders. This is a guy that actually believed in British forms of government. He believed in having an executive that served for life, senators that served for life at a point, for the executive to actually appoint the state governors at one point. In this way, he was actually an example of what the fathers didn't think. The founding fathers didn't think more than he was what the founding fathers did think. One other thing is he actually, when James Madison proposed the Virginia Plan, which became the basis for the Constitution, the final version, he actually proposed a countermeasure at the time, which would do away with state sovereignty completely and actually make us part of one state. The other founding fathers never really seriously entertained these proposals. And again, it makes him more of the outlier than consistent with the rest of the founders. He's actually an interesting character because during the time of the Federalist Papers and during the time of the ratifying conventions for the Constitution, he actually did argue for a limited scope of government. But once he became in power and the first Secretary of the Treasury, you know, we've seen this a million times, he started to argue that the Necessary and Proper Clause and the General Welfare Clause kind of justify some of the things he wanted to do. But he was kind of unique in that perspective. The last thing I want to touch on before kind of concluding here is slavery. And we hear all the time, people say that the Constitution encourages or protects slavery, right? You know, you hear this all the time. It's a common gripe against certain founders. And I'd love to elaborate on certain things in this regard in the future meetings. But I just wanted to talk about how I believe that the actual text of the Constitution neither completely sanctions or condemns slavery, but I do believe it contains two important clauses, two important measures that actually were intended to curtail the expansion of slavery. The first is the Three-Fifths Compromise, and this was offered by James Wilson of North Carolina and Roger Sherman of Connecticut. Roger Sherman was actually an interesting character, one of my favorite founding fathers, but you don't hear that much about him. He was a guy that Thomas Jefferson said never said a foolish thing in his life. They proposed a Three-Fifths Compromise to allow for the total slave populations in the South to be counted as for 3/5 of the total representation in the House of Representatives and the Electoral College. Contrary to popular mantra, this had nothing to do with the actual worth of a person. This did not make people 3/5 of a person. They did not like chop themselves right here and become 3/5 of a person. They were counted in the census. And by the way, if government had more respect for those people at those times, the constitutionally protected Bill of Rights would apply to them. So it had nothing to do with the individual worth of black people. This was very controversial to the South. The Southern representatives like Edward Rutledge and John Rutledge, they always talked about how they wanted, you know, a full representation. Everyone counts as a person. This was very controversial, but it actually lessened the slave power in the South because it allowed them to have less less kind of influence over the presidential elections and less seats in the House of Representatives. The other thing is the Sunset Clause on the international slave trade. This is found in Article 1, Section 9. The founders put in a provision that would ban the international slave trade by 1808. And Thomas Jefferson happened to be the president in that time. He actually made it a priority to sign this legislation and make sure that both houses of Congress actually pass it. Jefferson had long been he had long hated the international slave trade as it was forced by the British. In fact, in the original version of the Declaration of Independence that he constructed with the Committee of Five, there was a scathing indictment on the British instituted international slave trade. This was eventually taken out by the Continental Congress because they feared that, you know, the rest of the representatives would not want to abide by it. But it did help curtail importation of new slaves. And Jefferson did this whilst owning slaves indeed, but that I would like to elaborate on at another time as well. These two things in particular have formed part of the argument for the slavery, for the Constitution's text as being an anti-slavery document. In fact, Lysander Spooner had a very great book that I highly recommend called The Unconstitutionality of Slavery, which came out in 1845, that I highly recommend reading. This argument has been around a long time, but today we only hear about the arguments of Daniel Webster and William Lloyd Garrison, people that thought that the Constitution in itself actually protected slavery. That or argument by Lysander Spooner has effectively been torn from our proverbial book of history, stolen from our ledger, if you will. So it's a really highly recommended read. Just to summate the kind of what I wanted to discuss today and touch on, I just wanted to refer to a Thomas Jefferson quote that I really believe applies to our life almost all the time. And Jefferson wrote this in 1800. He said, "I've sworn upon the altar of God eternal hostility against all forms of tyranny over the mind of man." And if we allow institutions to kind of redefine lessons on the Constitution, we just hurt ourselves. If we allow them to redefine the origins of our liberties, we hurt ourselves. Our liberties were given to us by God and held as essential maxims long before all the governments of man ever existed, long before Congress, long before the Parliament. So it behooves us to realize this and realize that if the physical manifestation of the Constitution gets shredded, our rights do not go away, and we need to teach that to others. So let's just recognize that, and as we move on, I really appreciate everyone's attentive nature here, and I hereby yield the rest of my time to Mandy because she has so much to say tonight. Just kidding. All right. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
That was awesome. Thank you very much, Dave. Just getting back into politics, we were active in college 10 years ago, and this is the first time Benner's really gotten back into politics. That was pretty cool, wasn't it? So, I want to do two housekeeping notes. Tell us what you think about tonight. You guys all being here means you're founding fathers and founding mothers of the East Metro Tea Party. I've got a comment box in the back. I got paper in front of that, and I got a pen, all right, to make it easy for you. If it's too hot in here, let me know about that. If it's too packed, then it's too hot, and it's too packed, right? Well, the packed part's a good part. Let us know, is it better seeing Jack Rogers up here, or is it better seeing a younger guy like myself up here? Give us that feedback so that we can go forward with it. So that's the comment back box back there in the back. The other thing is, let us know who you are. Get on our email list. This is just the thing you got to do in politics. And let us know a little bit more about yourself. If you want to, if you belong to another Tea Party, let us know on it. I got a little part on there that says, ask that question. Let me know if you want to help with monthly events, because it would be very helpful to Benner and I to have some other planners and organizers in here. And the other thing I'd like to know, because I know the media is going to be interested in to find out what we all care about the most, tell me what political issue is the most important to you. And I heard one guy put tyranny. That's a good one, but that's kind of hard to define. Economics, war, spending, budget, things like that. Give me a little feedback. So I'm going to have this thing go around the room. If you haven't signed in the back, do so on this form right here. Okay, I'm going to bring the showman back up here for the political entertainment hour. This is what distinguishes us from other people. I know those were really awesome presentations, mine on the debt and Benner on the Constitution. I know that. You don't have to write them in the comment box. But I'll tell you, listen. I mean, I haven't got that stress ball back yet. I can tell you guys are still a little stressed. There you go.
She has been playing with it.
Okay, she has. So do order more drinks if you need to, because of finding out how much people hurt the general welfare clause and how much debt we've added.
I'll take care of her, Jake.
Thank you very much, Karen. But the other thing that's very important is we got to have some fun, and I can think of nothing better than the first edition of The Price is Right, the 1913 edition.
He asked me to look like, he said I look like Drew Carey. That's why I picked The Price is Right. And I'm going, I think I'm heavier yet than Drew, but what the heck? And never attack a man with a full arsenal of notes up here that can just cut you to ribbons. If we have time, I'll tell you the story about the first Thanksgiving with his family and the pregnant turkey. It's hilarious. I use it in when I go to preach. After I met Jake and I learned this story, I've used it because it's a wonderful story, and it will absolutely tear your ribs to pieces. But let's start this. Who's our first guest tonight?
Well, we gotta ask the audience who wants to come on down.
Who wants to come down? Be the first contestant. You come on down. What's your name?
Mary.
Mary. Oh. Now, are you familiar how this game works? We'll show you the product right here. You guess the price in $1913. Were they? Closest guess to the actual price without going over wins.
Okay.
So I need another contestant, don't I?
Yeah.
Can I have another volunteer? We have a Mary. How about you right there? You, raise your hand and volunteer. Come on up. Stop it. Come on up. Please stop it. Come forward. Yeah, I will.
Did she show the direction? She said, I can do this.
All right, this young lady said her name was Stop It, and while we're waiting for her to come up, what kind of prizes do we have for the gifts tonight, Jake?
Well, that wonderful investment advising firm has bought two $10 gift cards to Caribou Coffee. So if you like coffee and you support your local Minnesota brew house, actually it's not Minnesota anymore.
No, I know.
Hey, okay. Well, it's got roots in Minnesota. You can get a $10 gift card if you get the closest price.
And that's for a full half cup, the way the economy is moving. Now, stop it. What is your real name?
Andrea.
Andrea. So we got Andrea and Mary. Are you ready for this first item? Jake, what do we have as our first item?
Well, Jack, we have a box, 2-pound box of baking soda, which I do believe exists.
See this? Okay. All righty. They didn't come in this box, so you got to pretend it is an old-time box, okay? Here you go. You want to shake it, hold it. Okay, do you guys know what that is used for?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Making volcanoes, that means you got kids. Okay. All right. Mary, you get to guess first.
I'm going to say 7 cents.
7 cents. Okay. And you, Andrea?
3 cents.
3 cents. Okay, now before we give the answer, and I fall down here from the wires. Let's hear audience applause. Who thinks Mary with 7 cents is closest? Who thinks Andrea with 3 cents is closest? Okay, now, the closest without going over, okay? And Jake, who is the winner?
Our winner is Mary with 8 cents. Woo!
Woo! All right.
I was baking soda.
Retail price is $1.89 today.
All right. All righty, ladies, take your seats. I need two guys. I need a guy. I need a guy. Somebody raise your hand.
What about Bob?
Okay, Bob, come on up. I need one more. Right there. Come on up. You're dying to be up here. Come on up here. And your name is still Bob?
Jim.
Jim.
Okay, Bob. That's not Jim Bob. It's just Jim. Okay.
Warren.
Warren. Okay. And what next? Stand over here. You're the contestant. Right. All righty. Are you ready?
I am ready. Our next item is a box of staples.
Okay. Box of staples. You want to feel them? What do you think? What do you think? 1913.
No.
You got to guess. I'm the.
Right on.
Oh man. Okay, I'll go for
4 cents.
I'll go five.
Five. Okay, audience, what do you think? There isn't any staples. That was a trick question. Good going. Woo! You got it right, but stay up here. We'll give you a shot to win. Okay, what's the last item we got coming up here?
Jack, our last item I do believe existed in 1913. That is a loaf of bread. It probably wasn't brown bear at the time, 12 grain, but it's a loaf of bread. What did that go for?
Leavened or unleavened?
Well, that goes to my car, first of all. All righty. What do you think?
Five.
Loaf of bread.
Five.
10 cents.
Five.
9 cents. Oh, you playing it sharp. Okay. And Jake, what do we have?
Our answer is 13.
Woo! Jim Bob, give him a hand. That concludes the first edition of The Price is Right. Here you go, Jake.
Now, why do we do that? Anyone have an idea? Why do we do that? It is fun. That's right. But what's the point we're trying to drive home with you guys? Inflation, right? Our dollars being devalued. What's significant about 1913? Anyone tell me that? The Fed what? The Fed was created in 1913. The Federal Reserve is what actually owns or creates our money. They're the one that either increases or decreases the supply of money. And when you increase more money, what generally happens to prices in the economy? They go up, right? So that's your lesson on inflation. About a 97 to 98% drop in the value of the dollar since the start of the Federal Reserve. And those numbers are looking very ugly these days. Okay, it is my distinct pleasure to show you guys your house member here in Lake Elmo. She is a fighter at the Capitol of Liberty. She is so Tea Party that when general people like Tony Hernandez runs for office and puts a little sticker on his car, she wraps her car in the Constitution. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Representative Kathy Lohmer.
I just got here about 5 minutes ago, and I'm just blown away by the number of people here. This is absolutely so exciting. This is great. Wonderful. I'm so glad you started this Tea Party, Jake, and all of you who've been involved. I'm not really sure, but thanks a lot for being here. It's really an honor to be up here. And just Jake had Facebooked me and said, I'm doing this, and would you like to come by and say a few words. It is your district. So we're really kind of in my district right now. We're pretty much right on the edge of it. So I'm Kathy Lohmer. I serve District 39B, which is St. Mary's Point up through Grant and Lake Elmo, Oak Park Heights, Stillwater, not all of Stillwater, but about 13 communities. So it is a real honor to be here. I decided to run for office in 2008 because I really am one of you. I saw the government just getting out of control and the spending and taking away our liberties and taking away our rights. And my son was serving a 15-month deployment in Iraq, and I just started thinking, you know, what am I willing to do? Maybe it's time for me to step up and just go in there with these ideas of limited government and stop spending money we don't have and all that. And I lost in 2008, and that was kind of a bummer. But if you remember, that was Obama's big year coming in, and the Democrats really stayed in power that year. So I'm not a quitter, and I came back in 10, and I did it again, and was successful. And it was just such an awesome privilege and honor to be down there, and to be down there in the majority with Representative Mary Franson, who's sitting here in the front. And I think there were 33 freshman Republicans in our class, and it was just awesome. It was overwhelming because it's a huge job, and it feels like drinking out of a fire hose every day. But yet we were there, and we were able to get a lot of things done, like erase a $5 billion budget deficit without raising taxes, and come up with a $2 billion surplus, and you know, even tried to pay back the shift a couple times. But for whatever reason, the voters weren't hearing that message last time, and unfortunately, we lost that majority. I did fortunately get back in this election, and Mary and I both had very, very a lot of money spent against us, and she made it back, but by a pretty slim margin, because they really tried hard. They tried hard to get all of us out. They spent more money against me than anyone else in the House, and I won by 6 points, so I'm just extremely And as I look around this room, it's because so many people I see here helping me out. Nice to see you again, and just there's lots of folks here, and so I thank you so much for that. So like Jake mentioned, you probably can't get really any more Tea Party than wrapping your car in the Constitution. And that was really something people would stop me on the streets, even in Minneapolis. They'd be like, wow, who are you? Your car is wrapped in the Constitution flag. This is awesome. So I think thanks to Mr. Glasgow back there with that great idea, it made a difference, and people really knew who I was and what I stood for. And I think that's one of the reasons that I did get elected, because I'm true to my word, and I don't care what the political winds are, and I don't care. I just want to do the right thing. So I guess, like I said, I'm really grateful that you're all here. You know, when we have a totally DFL-controlled legislature and governor, really our last line of defense is all of you and your voices. And so it's so important right now that you are here, that you keep working to get good conservatives elected, and yet we really need to hear your voice. I guess I thought I would just talk for a couple minutes just about some of the happenings down at the Capitol, and I'm assuming that a lot of you follow pretty closely what's going on down there, but it's nothing like actually being there, so I'll just go through a few things and then I can take some questions afterwards. But I serve on Health and Human Services Policy, Public Safety, and the Jobs Committee. And probably the most interesting bills that have come through so far in my committees, well, two of them, Health Insurance Exchange, but the gun bills. And maybe a lot of you were down at the Capitol when we had 3 days of hearings. And I'm just telling you the story about, in case you don't know, there were a lot of really bad bills presented that week, but two of the worst were presented by Representative Alice Hausman from the Roseville area. The first bill she presented and promptly excused herself, told the chair she had to go meet with some school kids at the Ordway or something, which is absolutely, I've never seen anything like that. I mean, if you are a legislator presenting a bill and then there's public testimony, any testimony, you should be there to hear it. And we had a packed hearing room. We had two overflow rooms. We had testimony morning and night, and she wasn't there to hear any of it. And on her second bill, she wasn't even there to present the bill. She actually had a paid lobbyist from the other side present her bill. So I just think that's tragic and sad. And I just have to commend all of the folks that were there. There, it was, I don't know, 9-1 people that were very articulate in defending their Second Amendment rights. Amen. And they did a great, great job. And just the showing, and I was getting between 500 and 700 emails a day. No, a week, I'm sorry. A week, for about 3 weeks on this issue. And I think that everybody on that committee was getting that, including the chair. And I think that's the reason that we are not going to see, I mean, we are going to have a gun bill fight on the floor, but it won't be anything like they wanted to do. So I think you should all give yourself a lot of credit for that. Your voice is so good. You know, they're talking about the minimum wage going up to $9.55 an hour. And that was just a story about the jobs committee that I was on, and we had that testimony. We actually had Lil Linder. I don't know if Lil would even be here. Are you here? Yes, I'm so glad you're here. She came down, bless her heart, never had done it before, but came down and talked to our committee. And the one thing that really sticks in my mind about what you said is that you hire about 900 seasonal workers a year. And with minimum wage, you would be lucky to hire 600. So what are we doing here? What are we doing to people who need work, need jobs, students? And you know, this is just such a bad bill. So thank you, Will, for coming down and talking to us. The other thing I think that's really happening at the Capitol right now is it's union payback time, big time. So all the money that was spent to get that majority, I mean, there was a lot of Alita Messinger money that was spent, but there was a lot of union money that was spent, and you really see it because we have the daycare unionization, we have the PCA unionization, we have the nursing staff ratios, which is right out of the union playbook. We have allowing school districts to only be able to purchase their health insurance through PEEP, which is the union insurance company. You know, there's just, it's like everywhere we turn, there's union bills, so that's pretty sad. And then we've got the anti-bullying bill that I heard just today just came up with a $1 million fiscal note, which is good news in a way because maybe it'll be too expensive, but that's a really, really bad bill for Liberty and especially for schools, private schools, homeschools. It's just a really bad bill. And of course, all the taxes that they just want to raise taxes on, everything from beer to your babysitter. They want to raise $2 billion, so where's it going to come from? It's going to come out of your pockets. They are bringing up, of course, what they accused us of, you know, so much, the divisive social issues. So we've got gay marriage to look forward to, that debate pretty soon, unfortunately. And probably the most, to me, the most serious and harmful bill that's already been passed was the health insurance exchange. By far and away, the worst piece of legislation that will ever pass through that state house, in my view. And we fought hard, but we lost that battle, and Dayton signed it. So anyway, you're all here, and I don't want to be such a downer that you're thinking it's hopeless. It's not hopeless. It's never hopeless, right? So we have 2014 to look forward to, and I just would really encourage you all to do what you can to get involved, to speak up, to write letters to the editor. You know, every candidate needs financial help. They just need the support. They need people to help them in parades, whatever it is, and just, you know, find the candidate from your area. Find out what they really stand for, because unfortunately, we're not even always on the same team in our party. And so we really need to make sure that we're finding people who have conservative principles that where that are, in my view. So talk to your friends and neighbors. Don't be afraid to talk about politics. I mean, everybody says, you know, talk about religion, don't talk about politics. And I kind of think that's how we got in this situation that we're in, because we're afraid to talk about these things that are really important. So I would really encourage you to do that. And I just, again, want to just thank you all for being here and for your support and for your help. And I could be happy to answer a couple questions if you like. I don't serve on any education.
The question was, I heard that the MEA is pushing, as far as, you know, say they help with the election, that they were pushing as far as to prevent having to do minimum standards. I guess like 2 years ago, they were pushed through as far as they had to apply, you know, have minimum standards before they become teachers. But now they're trying to take that away as a payback to them for helping out the election.
Call a friend. Mary, do you know the answer to that question? Because you don't serve in education either. I don't know.
It failed.
It failed?
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. Very good. If there's so much going on down there, I don't always know everything if it's not in my committee.
Where are we going to get to fire Governor Dayton? Yeah.
That is a great question.
Jason Lewis.
Oh, for Governor Jason Lewis?
Yeah. He was just at our BPOU.
Yeah? How about Senate? How about Senate? I thought I heard he might be running for Senate, but I don't know anything. Pardon me?
Governor Lomer.
That's very kind. I'm really happy just representing people on this level, so. Anybody else have anything?
Is it your sense that the gay marriage bill that the DFL is floating does or does not have the votes to get through, and is Garofalo's civil union bill, as far as you know, flaking off any of the outstate DFLers? Do you need to repeat that?
No, I heard the question. I just have my own take on that whole thing. I feel like we have a governor who is absolutely, you know, the worst governor. I mean, he's not doing a very good job. Can't even make a, you know, decision about what to tax and what not to tax. We have the DFL, you know, just going off the reservation, doing so many things that we can run next time just based on all the bad politics that have gone on. And, you know, they accused us of this divisive social issue business, and so why we're, I don't think personally that we should even be having a discussion on our side. I think that we should be focused on the economy and taxes and getting things back. And as far as, I don't know if they have the votes for it on the DFL side. We'll see. If they come to the floor, they'll have the votes, but let's hope and pray they don't. Well, thanks again. Thanks for letting me have a few minutes here. Great to see you.
Thanks very much, Kathy, for coming in. Before we get to our main speaker here tonight, I saw my friend Jenna Carlson coming to the crowd. She has not been involved in political process. Raise your hand, Jenna. She is actually a veteran of Afghanistan and Iraq. And I'm so glad to have her here today. And then my other friend, Matt Wolf, is going to really, he's going to just go in his little corner because he's so shy. But Matt Wolf, raise your hand in the back. Matt was part of the gang with Benner and me at college that were really active in politics. Matt really hasn't been, but he's been working his way up the corporate ladder. You know, he's a capitalist. And we brought him here tonight, and he's got his lovely girlfriend, Brandy, with him tonight. So give a round of applause for Matt coming out here. All right, Jack, we're going to try to make this thing work. Let's hope the audio works with this, because it's going to be a better intro that way.
I'm going to take 1 minute to tell that Turkey. His mother gets some excuse to send his wife out of the house. Go get something. And when she did, they unstuffed the turkey and put a Cornish game hen inside. Put the stuffing back inside. All right? I'm just giving you some of the bloodlines that this man comes from, okay? So when they come back, now the turkey has been put into the oven, and they're waiting, and unbeknownst to her, she has no idea. But they ask her, we're so excited to eat your first Thanksgiving turkey. So she takes it out, it's perfect, it's glistening, it looks moist. In fact, did they have turkey on the menu? I'm starting to get hungry here. They take this out, and so she, they have their prayer, they're starting to cut the turkey, she's drawing the dressing out, and she feel something. She stops for a minute. Now, can you imagine everybody goes silent and they're holding good straight faces? And she says, there's something in here I got to take out. She takes it out. She sees this Cornish game hen. His mother said, you cooked a pregnant turkey. She burst into tears. It took them 2 hours to convince her that turkeys lay eggs, and she is one of the biggest proponents and supporter for pro-life that you've ever seen. Now, I won't be able to take communion if I don't tell you it didn't really happen, but I warned him about picking on me. Is the video ready to go?
It is ready to go.
Alrighty, this is a video of Jim Neuberger, and if you've ever, I've been down and visiting him, and I learned this by going down to the Capitol lately. The best argument against democracy is a 15-minute conversation with any of the liberals in the Minnesota House or Senate. And you got to go to Jim's office just to come back down to the ground to know you're not in some fantasy land. I tell you, you got to get over there. He's wonderful to visit. So start it, see how we're doing with sound.
Let's hope sound works here. We got a little speaker.
Hold on 1 second. Steve, the sound is working now. How do we turn the volume up on the main speaker? I think it's all the way up on here. Give me 1 second. Miraculously, it's divine intervention. The sound system works now for our computer. I'll chalk that one up to God. Yeah, we should. Let's try this out here.
Actually, I wanted to echo back on, get to a point that was brought up. Those that were opposed to this, I yielded my time accordingly. The point I'm trying to make here, Mr. Chair, is we're trying to ban weapons that have more than, basically what this bill says is that if you have a firearm with that carries more than 7 rounds, and you're going to be a criminal. You're going to turn thousands of law-abiding citizens into criminals if you pass this thing. Now, people talk about trying to define assault. What is an assault?
You're talking about an assault weapon?
I'm talking about the word, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair, my blood pressure's going up. I'm talking about the term assault, all right? 25 years ago, I was a brand new paramedic. The very first assault I ever went on was a man stabbed in the side of the head with a 6-inch screwdriver. Is that an assault weapon?
Yes.
So let's be very careful when we start playing with semantics and we start playing with words here. Now let's talk about this a second. When you talk about high-capacity magazines, this bill, what I'm getting from this bill is the philosophy of this bill is that if you've got a 6-round revolver, that's all you need for personal protection. Well, is it? Well, if it's one-on-one, it's fine, maybe. Depends on how well of a shot you are. Now we heard people talk about testimony here about having these high capacity magazines. What do you do if you're a mother and if there's a home invasion? What do you do when there are more than one attacker? What do you do when you are in your car or you are in your home and there's a gang that's coming after you? People smile and shake their heads no. Well, wait a minute. What happened post Katrina? There was chaos. There was no law enforcement, there was no military, there was chaos in the streets. High-capacity magazines have a place in, I don't call these assault weapons, I call them defense weapons. And law-abiding citizens who obey the law should not be denied their Second Amendment rights to have these.
Yes. That's truly a person representing with values there, representing every one of you, even if you don't even live in his district. He comes from House District 15B north of by Becker, and there's a Tea Party, active Tea Party up there that support him. But we need to, as all of the Tea Parties together, support men and women that stay committed to get kicked around by their own caucus, to get kicked around by the press, to get kicked around by the leftists. They need us. We're the only ones that can heal them, support them, and help them. Welcome, Jim Neuberger.
Thank you, Dad. Thank you. I want to thank you all for being here tonight. This is truly outstanding. What about Bob? Sorry, that's an inside joke. Before I go on anywhere here, I just want to do a quick shout out. Mary, don't you sneak off yet. Do we have any of our elected officials, either present or past? If you're here, would you please stand up for a second? Would you stand up if you're currently serving city council, I don't care, county commission, Minnesota House, school board? If you're serving, I don't care. Please stand up. Okay, BPO, how about political BPO leadership or congressional district leadership, past or present? If you have, please stand up. Joe Salmon, you better stand up. I know you're back there.
Okay. Now wait a second. Before we do that, let's give them all a round of applause. Thank you. And if you, the other thing I want to do is I want to call attention to the folks. If you've ever run before, if you've run, please stand up. Even if you didn't win, please stand up. Thank you. These are the folks. It's really easy to kind of stand in the spotlight when you win, but it's the folks who have put themselves out there in these elections and who haven't won, that have come forward. And I want to thank you all for running. And please do so again. We need you. Don't let that get between you and what you really feel your calling is to do. So, without any further ado, comrades, yes. As Jack was saying, I'm from the Becker area. I've been to the former Soviet Union. Some of you have probably heard this spiel, but I've been there 8 times. My very first trip was right after the Iron Curtain came down. It was about 1991, 92, right around there. And I was sitting in the front of an ambulance with one of my partners, as I've been a paramedic forever. And I'm 49 years old, so 25. I was 24 years old when I started in first year. And my partner looks at me and goes, Jim, he goes, do you want to go on a missions trip to Russia? And I'm just like, sure, yeah, I'll go. And I said, cool. No, I didn't really mean it, you know, but I just said, sure, I'll go. Why not? Sounds good. Let's. What else? What's for lunch? About 3 days later, he drops these pile of paper in my lap. He says, here's all the forms. Start filling them out. I'm going, man, what is this? So I had to go home and explain to my wife, hey, baby, I'm going to Russia. So that was the start of a long and very interesting career. How many folks here have ever been to the former Soviet Union? If you have, raise your hand. Okay. So you folks know. You got an idea of what we could possibly be facing. I was in a small village in Romania. I don't even know where it is to this day. It was the city that it was closest to is on the map. the village I was in, I don't know. I don't even remember the name of the place. I couldn't pronounce it. And I'm sitting in this little tiny place in the middle of nowhere over on the Croatian border. And this is back when the fighting was still going on, just about 15 miles from where we were. And we're having lunch. And these Romanians start giving me the third degree. They all have satellite television. And they watch American television, they watch American news, and they are just ripping on me, you know? And their primary question was, what are you doing in America? Don't you see? This is the end result of where you're going. What's going on? Stop it, you know? And this was back when Hillary Clinton was running against Barack Obama for the DFL, the Democratic nomination for president. And I kept, you know, I reassured these folks. I said, she's not gonna win. If she does, she's not gonna win, and everything's gonna be okay. Well, history proves me wrong. So stay involved. Now I want to let you know, a little bit nervous here, but that's okay. I've been involved in about 5 different tea parties, going back a few years. I've done some work with Jack and done some work with some other tea parties to see some other tea party folks here. And I'm glad you're here. What is the tea party? Really, what is it? What is it? Is it taxed enough already?
Yes.
Okay, sure it is. But step out of that for a second. What is the Tea Party? The Tea Party, I have come to conclude, really is the conscience of the conservative movement. That's what the Tea Party is. Sitting, look to your left, look to your right. You're here because you have a core set of values. There are things that you believe that are unshakable. That is the very conscience of the conservative movement. And I want to thank you all for being here. This is very vital that you're here. And I want to tell you, it's really encouraging, because some of the Tea Party events that we go to, the majority of the folks are all 50 and older. Nothing wrong with that. Okay, I'm 49, so I can still call you old. However, you're only a decade or two away from retirement. And as I look around the room here, I see the full spectrum of ages. I see young people, I see older people that have experience, and I see people that are coming up, and this is good. This is really good. This is vital. So I want to congratulate you, Jake, especially. Good job.
Thank you.
Good job. Excellent.
Yep. I do have to put in a shameless plug. Cindy Pugh, she is a good Tea Party person. She runs the Southwest Metro Tea Party. She sends her greetings. She wanted to be here tonight. She couldn't be. If you're ever in the Southwest Metro, they're a very vibrant and active Tea Party down in the Southwest Metro, like I said. If you're ever down in that area, I left a little stack of these. I promised her I would do that, and so they're back on the table. So if you're down in that area and you're interested, please go. So I want to touch on a couple of things, since this is your very first Tea Party event. And I've watched a number of Tea Parties kind of come, kind of you ride that crest, you kind of grow, and then you kind of develop into what you're to become. And what I've come across and what I've come away from and what I've learned from is this, and I want to give you this as you start on this conservative journey, is how to be effective. Really, how to be effective. Because this is what's going to count. Is first and foremost, I want to tell you, don't just come together to regurgitate what you hear on talk radio. You can do that in your car to your liberal family members and friends, and it will drive them crazy, okay? Come here if you want to reiterate or regurgitate or re-whatever ate or see what you ate on talk radio. No, that's fine, but keep it to a limit. Don't make this just a sounding board for what everybody listened to on their way here, okay? Because that's not going to carry you. It'll work for a while, but it won't carry you. Act. That's what you need to do. You need to act. You need to find candidates for everything. It doesn't matter what it is. Dog catcher to president, find a candidate that you line up with, someone, man or woman, that you can get behind and support. Because that's probably the most effective thing you can do, is find people and support them, get behind them and volunteer for them. And I tell people, pick your battles. As a Tea Party, you're going to have to decide, your leadership, folks, that what are the battles here that this Tea Party can be most effective at. I've been at tea parties where they've said, okay, we're gonna get involved in every single battle, every single fight, from the county commission all the way up to the presidency. We're gonna talk about everything, we're gonna fight every fight, and that goes for about 3 months, and everyone goes, wow, we're burned out. So follow your leadership. Pick your battles. Pick a couple key areas, and you know what, go after them. Go after them like bloodhounds. Don't let go. You know, I've talked, one of my personal heroes in life is Winston Churchill. And he had an expression. In fact, I've got his picture. My wife gave me a picture of Winston Churchill. I have it on my desk. And I kid people, when school kids come in, I ask them, I say, who is that? They're like, I don't know. And I say, well, that's my first wife. You know, they're like, no, I'm just kidding. But he had a phrase. It was called KBO. It was keep buggering on. Don't give up. Never quit. Never, ever quit. Keep buggering on. Because you know what? Things come in, they go in tides, they go in waves, and we can do this. We can ride through this slump right now that we're in. We can take Minnesota back. It can happen. That's not going to be easy, but we can do it. It's doable. The other thing I want to encourage you to do, this is something that if you talk to anybody that's been in the party at all or any conservative group, don't over-sharpen your knife. If you have a candidate or if you have an elected official, Ronald Reagan said, if you can agree on 80%, then leave them alone. Don't crucify them over the 20%. Because what you're going to do is you're going to destroy them. You're going to wear them out. Take that energy, take that anger, take that angst, and go after the liberal left, who is 100% against you. Go after them. So folks wanted me to touch on a couple of things here. And the one thing I really want to touch on is our Second Amendment rights. I used to think that the First Amendment was the most important. I got all my notes written here so I don't screw up. But I used to think that the First Amendment was the most important, because without the freedom of speech, you have nothing. I've come to learn over the past couple of years, without the freedom to defend that, Everything rests on the Second Amendment. Absolutely. Everything rests on the Second Amendment. That is the foundational piece that everything, if we lose that, we lose it all. Mm-hmm. So Second Amendment rights are very important to me. And as you know, there was a gun bill that passed through committee. And it went right down party lines. And I want to applaud Kathy Lohmer. She she was a stalwart in our committee, and there was she was one of those people that you just knew she wasn't going to cave, and she did a great job. And there was one Democrat that sided with us, and I'm going to do a shout out to him. His name is John Ward. Now, regardless of how you feel about John Ward, he voted in favor of our Second Amendment rights, and he's from Greater Minnesota. He's up by the Bemidji area, so you got to call. Yeah, you got to give credit where credit is due. And this is a Tea Party, not a Republican event, so I can do that. Okay. There's a bill that's coming up that's scaring me. This passed by one vote, and I want to call your attention to this. This is an action item I think that you might want to consider. This is House File. Oops. 285. This is the John Lesch bill. This is the one that passed. This is the one that is going to go to the House floor. I'm not sure of its status in the Senate, but you know, the Senate, they wear wigs, and I don't care. I want to read to you. We need to look at this. House File 285, for those of you with pencils and paper and want to look at this later, you can get it on the internet. It says that the following persons shall not be entitled to possess ammunition or a pistol or a semi-automatic military-style assault weapon or any other firearm. These are the ineligible people. Now, there's three pages of this, but there's one part that I really want to focus on and draw your attention to. And this is one of the things that scares me to death. Section 3.1, I'll read a little bit of this to you. A person who is or has ever been ordered, committed to in Minnesota or elsewhere by judicial determination, blah, 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 that the person is mentally ill, developmentally disabled, or mentally ill and dangerous to the public, as defined in Section 253B, whether or not if they've been to a treatment facility. Anyone who has been found to be incompetent to stand trial, but guilty of mental illness, or unless the person's ability to possess a firearm has been restored. And if you dig into this a little bit more, it says here, a person who's ever been convicted in the state of Minnesota or elsewhere of a misdemeanor or a gross misdemeanor, unless 3 years has elapsed during the time of your conviction, and you haven't been convicted of anything else, a paraphrase there. Anyone that has ever been committed for habitual use of marijuana, unless you're going to lose your right to have a firearm here. Anyone that's ever been committed for chemical dependency or completed a treatment program. Ever been committed. Now today on the House floor, I'm sitting there and trying to get some things done, and they pass out stuff all the time. And we got this handout today, 4 hours ago. One in four people in Minnesota have had some form of mental illness. Okay? Here in Minnesota. So think about it. What's one of the most common causes of depression in women? Postpartum? Okay? Well, yeah, men. You know what, Jack? That goes back to an old phrase that every problem that women can ever experience has the three letters M-E-N in it. You figure that out. So one in four people have been, think about this, postpartum depression in women, okay? You have a baby, you suffer from postpartum depression for a week, 2 weeks, a month, 2 months, whatever, and then you recover. 20 years later, if you were committed for that, 20 years later, according to this, you had a mental illness history. There goes your Second Amendment rights. How about men? You know, you lose your job, you get depressed. Oh, yeah. Or if in the middle of December and it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon and it gets dark, it's pitch dark, and you're driving around with your headlights and you go to your doctor for a checkup, and you say, you know, doc, this getting dark thing at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it's just got me kind of mopey and down. Well, if you get treated for that, guess what? Yeah. There go your Second Amendment rights.
How about coming back from war zone?
Come back from any post-traumatic, any PTSD. Or how's this? Think about this. What if you really need help? Okay? Let's say you've got a little history of depression. It's touching, it's nothing serious, but let's say you have a history of it. And you love to hunt. Well, that means if I want to go get treatment for my depression, now I got to give up all my shotguns. I can't hunt ever again. What good is that going to do? There are holes in this bill that you can drive a truck through. One in four, according to this bill, will, right out of the chute, stand to lose their Second Amendment rights.
Does that include household, then? If you have a spouse, then the spouse can't have it either?
That hasn't been addressed, okay. So I can't answer that. But it would be. So here's the point. Now, we sat there for days listening to testimony from experts. Some of you were there. We had overflow rooms. We listened to so many folks. And the one of the experts that got up and testified to us that really stuck with me was one of the mental health experts. They got up and they said, 94% of people with mental illness usually recover, or they are not a substantial threat to other people. They're not. It's roughly 4 to 6% of the mental health patients community that would be classified, according to the experts that we had, you have expert testimony, would be classified as a danger to society. So we're going to punish 100% of anyone with a mental health history. That means 1 out of 4 in Minnesota could lose their Second Amendment rights if this bill goes through. This is what I wanted you to do. When I said don't over-sharpen your knife and go after the liberal left. First of all, when this bill comes to the floor for a debate and it comes to the floor for a vote, go ahead and email me. That's great. I love those emails. And I try to look at all of them. But call, write letters, and email all of the members of the DFL, especially from Greater Minnesota, and let them know. And if you have family members or friends, loved ones, people you work with, that live in those outstate areas, let them know. And if I represent the Becker area, and if someone calls me up and says, you know, I live in Woodbury, but you know, my parents live in Becker, guess what? You got my attention. More so than you would if you just said, I live in Woodbury. So draw a connection if you can do that, because that's very effective. And let them know, put the pressure on. We can probably defeat this on the floor of the Minnesota House. We can probably vote it down. We did a quick count of the general numbers, and the odds are good that we can do this. But it's politics, and it's never over until it's been over for 3 times. So it's not even over when it's over, and it's not even over when you're dead. So stay in the fight. And as a Tea Party, I want to congratulate you. You guys have done an outstanding job. Jake, great. Great job, guys. And stay in the fight. I want to thank you all for coming here tonight. And invite one more. I tell this is my little speech in a can that I tell to every group when I talk to them. The best way to double your numbers is just bring one more person. If everyone in this room brought one more person next week, guess what? You wouldn't be all in here. You'd have to get a room twice the size. So I can stand for any questions if anyone has any. I'll be more than happy. And before I do, I want to do a shout out. We got an outstanding senior member. Andrea Kiefer is in the back. She's a representative. Give it up for Andrea. She is an outstanding. It is a privilege to serve with her. Any questions? I'll be happy to take them.
A man carrying a sidearm up there. Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask everyone, hope this is okay, that everyone that has permit to carry their sidearm proudly. Bring it in here. And I think every Tea Party should have that, people carrying those things in, and you know, wear them on the side, wear them proud, and show them. The thing that scares liberals the most is seeing that. And it does. And watch them shaking their boots, and when they see that, they're going to think, oh, what's going on? So I think people should be carrying that. They do it in the southern states. I talked to a guy that sells guns. He moved from New Jersey, which is very liberal, down to North Carolina. He said, Bob, you got to see these guys here, they carry. And I think they do in Arizona, too. And they're not afraid of it, you know.
Yep. I was just asked. Jack Rogers just put a bug in my ear, so he can own this one. How many folks here have their permit to carry? Raise your hand. Okay. Now, go ahead and put your hands down. How many of you actively exercise that right?
Good for you. Good for you. Thanks for doing that. Because it's just not, it's not just your Second Amendment. It's not just your rights that you're protecting. It's everyone that's with you. It's everyone that's around you. So thank you, and God bless you. I'll stand for just like one or two more quick ones, and I'll let you go.
Yeah, and one too, as far as he was saying, I was up at the hearing that they had as far as, you know, just recently, as far as the one that they held us over. You know, we had a big recess, and then they, you know, basically stood us up for like an hour and 15 minutes, and then they adjourned the committee. And I was there for that one, and they said I was wearing my, I got snuck into the meeting a little late because I had it in the overflow room. But boy, you should have seen the look on the liberals when I sat amongst them. It was just like, you know, I was like, oh my gosh, the feeling, I could definitely feel the hate. And nothing to fear from me.
How do the state, how can the state laws trump the federal constitution?
How can the state laws?
I mean, they pass a gun law, and it says in the constitution there should be no state right to keep marriage, shall not be infringed. How can the states, why is that being allowed, that the states are allowed to trump the Constitution in the first place?
Right. I think that's a huge question. I think that over time, what has happened is that we've been asleep at the wheel. We have become a society that has said, if we can't solve the problem ourselves, we're going to pass the buck up the chain. And what we've done as states, as a culture, over time, over the generations, is we've said, well, we can't answer this question. So who's above us? Oh yeah, the federal government. So then the federal government goes ahead and does this. We've been asleep at the wheel, is what has happened. And I want to, I'm glad you brought that up. Scott, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I hear from a lot of folks, I door knocked all over the place as a lot of people did. And I hear from a lot of people that they're really worried. I'm gonna leave you with this. They're really worried about the direction our country is going, the direction our society is going. We hear every day about, you know, could we collapse? Could there be these problems? There's an innumerable amount of scenarios of what could happen. Okay, sure. You name it, it could possibly happen. But I'm gonna tell you one thing that we have as Americans that no other society has. Have you ever crashed your computer? I know my kids crash our computer all the time. And when you go on your computer, how many of you ever done a system restore? Where you get on your computer and you push that stupid function button really fast so it comes up in that weird mode, and then it asks you to reset at a date earlier before whatever it was that crashed your machine. So your machine forgets at what date it was and it restores itself to like a week before. And all of a sudden it just magically heals itself, right? Except for all the crap your kids download. So, yeah, let me tell you how I feel about that. Anyways, we have what essentially is what you could call a system restore in the United States. We have the Constitution, okay? Europe doesn't have that. South America doesn't have that. They don't have that tradition. They don't have that system restore point. So I want to leave you with this, that no matter what happens in our society, no matter what the future looks like in our society, regardless of where we go or what happens, we've got that system restore point, because people naturally are going to come around, they're going to come together, they're going to look at each other and say, God, what do we do? And the first answer is going to be, well, let's go back to where it all started. What's our system restore point? It's the Constitution. So we have that safety net. It's built into the fabric of our society, and I don't think that was by accident. I think that our founding fathers, when they put that document together, deep in the back of their minds, had that as an option. I think that's there.
That's fine to say, but mm-hmm. What do you do when your judicial, your executive, and your legislative, they don't care about the Constitution? What are you going to do? Run up there and say, "Here's my Constitution. Get out of my way."
No. Yes and no.
The only way to do it.
I'm talking the end game. What you're doing right now is what you should be doing, and that's meeting together and discussing what our liberties and what our rights are and what we hold near and dear in the Constitution. Absolutely. Will they listen to us? Probably not. But what I'm talking about when I said no, is I'm talking about when you get all the way to the end, when you exhaust it, those people probably won't be there. But as a society, we have a restore point, and we have the Constitution, and that's what we can go back to. Will we see it in our generation? Maybe not. The restore? Maybe, maybe not.
One of my best friends in the former Soviet Union, he was a former military analyst for the Russian Navy. And I remember having long, long talks with him about what happened in the post-Soviet Union, that whole collapse situation. Because things over there, their whole rebuild has been long, hard, and painful, what they've had to go through. And I asked him how he felt about that. And his reply was, I don't care. He said, if I have to suffer a little bit now so that my kids can live better, then it's worth it. And if we have to go through what seems to be what a lot of people are predicting, some type of a natural course of a downward turn, if we have to go through that, then so be it. But if we can do that, if we can ride through it and get back to our constitutional restore point, then we'll set the course for a better future for the generations to come. And you know what? That's worth it. That's worth it. And that's why we're here. And I want to thank you all for being here. And I just once again give it up. And then for Jack Rogers, thank you very much.
Very good job. Very good job. Quick show of hands in this room. On the sign-in roster, how many of you actually put up that guns was the most important issue to you? Show of hands here. Only two? Three? Four? That surprises me. Okay. Economics, I'm guessing, in the next. Okay. If you just heard what I said and said, well, what the heck's that sign-in roster? Now, has that just been there the whole time?
Yeah.
There you go. Karen finds that really funny. Okay, so make sure you sign in. Let us know. Give us some feedback so we know how to message to the public. Okay, Jack, I am drinking a fantastic fat tire from the bar. What are you having tonight?
That's what I have.
Well, I'm having a light beer to contain my rather elderly size.
So the only way I think two gentlemen, meeting for reasons of liberty, can the only way you can cheer one another and find conversation is if you give some business to the bar. So make sure, if you don't want to get business right now, there will be an after party. You can actually buy Benner a beer, and he'll let you know more about the Constitution. It's a nice luxury. Okay. The other thing I want to put out, there is a comment box. I know it's hot in here, and I know we were so popular tonight, we couldn't even get you a big enough room. So I know that already next month we're going to upsize here and fill that room with more people and hopefully get some AC running. I see Andrea Kiefer. I'm putting her on the spot, but she is a legislator, and I don't mind putting any legislator on the spot. Would you like to give a word to this fine group of Tea Partiers?
Glad to see there's such a great turnout. I live in Woodbury. I represent the district just south of here. It's really warm in here, so thanks for putting up with this. I'm not going to talk a lot, but I'd be happy to answer any questions. I was just across the street at the Children's Hospital fundraiser, so that's where I was this evening. I see a lot of familiar faces. Is there any issue that hasn't been covered or that you would like a little information on, a little inside baseball? There was a debate today on the floor about the radiation moratorium that Kim Norton decided to fence out all the competition, so Woodbury may be in jeopardy once more. Yes, Ms. Salmon.
What can you tell us about the Purple Caucus?
I really can't tell you much about the Purple Caucus, but she asked me, what can I tell you about the Purple Caucus? I haven't gone to any of their meetings. The Purple Caucus is a caucus, and anyone can caucus about anything. There's cancer caucus, obesity caucus. I guess they want to fight obesity. They don't want more obesity. And so the purple is, the idea is to mix red and blue and make purple. And so it's supposed to be a bipartisan caucus. I don't know anything about it. I haven't joined it. It's a sweet idea, I guess. Really, to work bipartisanly, that's our job. I mean, we need to write good legislation, get people to sign on the bills, and move forward good policy in the state. And that's really what I think a Purple Caucus should be. Is there another question? I don't know your name.
Doug.
Doug, hi.
Yeah, the status of this daycare unionization.
Yeah, okay. And
just a preface, my sister's been in daycare 25 years, and I come from a family of Democrats. This issue is probably going to push her over the edge
It's really, and I've been fighting it for 3 years now. They started to try to do this with the executive order. We fought this to the point where it went to the Supreme Court, and the judge actually voted in favor of us and said, no, this is unconstitutional what Dayton's trying to do. So now they're trying to do this in legislature, and they talk about this in committee. Oh, well, the governor was called unconstitutional, he couldn't do this, so we're going to do it legislatively. I've been fighting it in that, in those committees as well. I haven't heard that it's going to make it to the floor yet. If it does, what I would say, and if it passes, what I would say, is this is where grassroots could be really effective, just in your kind of case and other cases. You talk to your neighbors or your family that have daycares, and you say, make sure you vote. Make sure you vote no. Make sure that you have all the facts about what's going on here.
Well,
yes?
Just one other question. The way they're loading that ballot box with only the participants in the, and I don't know all
mm-hmm.
the verbiage,
so,
but the ones
so,
that are on the low-income program,
okay,
they
so,
don't know what's allowed to vote.
Yes,
right.
That's currently, it's a horrible bill.
Right.
You can find me on YouTube fighting this thing up and down. So they're saying that it's only going to affect people who receive CCAP money, that's something, I forget what it stands for. So they're the only ones that'll get to vote. And the threshold, typically, for any kind of PELRA, any kind of union type of contract, they usually ask for 30% of the vote to approve something. 30% of the voters need. This one's down to 10%. So the daycare, and you can email me and I'll get you all kinds of information on it, but there's an organization that does daycare kind of policy. It's $35 a year. And this group has been very active in fighting this too. I would just say at this point, make sure that if you do know a daycare provider, talk to them about it. Make sure they really understand what's going on. Sometimes when I get an email, it says, Rep. Kiefer, please support the unionization of daycare. I write right back to them, and I go, do you own a daycare? So far, I haven't gotten an answer back. So we're fighting it. Also, I don't know how many of you have a Democrat representative or a Democrat senator where you live, but contact them and tell them this is wrong and this is not right, and make sure that it's a transparent system. If we can get a transparent vote, there's a possibility we could vote no on it. Also, I'm hoping that there'll be some kind of sunset on the bill if it passes, that, okay, you get one vote, but this is done, and then if you want to try this again 10 years down the road, you need to redo the legislation. This needs to be just fought and fought and fought constantly. Any other questions? Yeah, hi, Lori.
I have one question for you. As far as on the, same-sex marriage situation, I heard, one thing, of course, they're putting a religious exclusion in it. But, of course, one thing they're not saying, that just covers the church. It does not cover the people outside the church. So if, say, I had a business mm-hmm. and a restaurant and a, mm-hmm. gay couple wanted to come in to celebrate their mm-hmm. wedding, in the, I couldn't refuse them. I'd be sued if I refused them.
Yeah.
And basically getting rid of religious, as far as trying to religious conscience.
Well, I don't know what's going to happen with that bill. It's out of our control. They won't get any Republican votes. And what I hear is they don't have enough Democrat votes. However, I also know that in a caucus, there's ways to twist arms and get people to vote with the caucus, even if in their heart of hearts they don't want to. So I can't make you any promises on that. I think it would be a sad day if this does get passed in the state, but I'm not guaranteeing that it won't. I don't know.
Yeah, and also what they also had as far as they're trying to push a civil union
mm-hmm.
with that.
I'm an author on that bill.
Okay, what's up with that?
It's just saying maybe this is a compromise, maybe this is a solution. It's taking this issue's taking up a lot of time, but I have to say the Republicans put it on the ballot. Not the Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
So, I told Republicans, be careful what you ask for and be prepared. What if it fails? Oh, it's not going to fail. So, Lori, just one second. Lori?
Minimum wage was.
Yeah, and that's another one I'm on. I've heard that bill three times in three different committees. I'm on the Living Wage Working Group Committee, too, and I'm fighting that tooth and nail. Oh, this is great. Every time a nonprofit comes in and asks for money to support the nonprofit, because they hire youth and they hire this and that, and that, I say, do your people in your program get paid minimum wage? Yes. Is this going to affect your budget? Well, yes. They're a real hesitant answer, but we've got them on record all over the place saying that. So it is going to affect them. Yes?
I missed the last part. Are you you said you're sponsoring a bill for civil unions? Mm-hmm. Is that correct? Can you tell a little bit about that?
My name's on it. It just says anywhere there says marriage that it would recognize civil union as well. I don't know if it's going to make any waves. I mean, it's got a little bit of press, but it's not. It's pretty much being ignored. And it's not what the far left wants. They're very, very angry.
Yeah, they want normalization.
They don't like it at all. Yes. Hi, Andrea.
How are you doing?
Okay.
My question with the civil unions is that something in the language? Because I haven't read through it yet. I did see something on the patch about it.
Mm-hmm.
You and I have done personal emails uh-huh. about this. So I'm wondering, with that, were you... Would you say that it would be civil unions across the board, gay, straight, wouldn't matter, that's what it would be called, and that churches would have freedom of religion to decide whether or not they would choose to marry?
It needs a little fine-tuning, I think. Right now, it's saying marriage or civil union.
Because you know that the activists are going to come after you for the marriage. That's the part they want.
Mm-hmm. I know.
So you take it out of their hands and give it to the free market and say, we're going to make
right.
everybody civil union.
Right.
And then churches get to choose who they will and will not marry.
Yeah. This is just, you know, I don't know, one of the blogs said, leave it to Rep. Kiefer and the Republicans to muddy up the waters. Well, you know what, maybe that was the intention, so we'll just see what happens. I mean, the same with the gun bill, when maybe the best thing is no action. Hi, Joe.
Well, we want to compliment you on the bill you just dropped last week and the courage it took to do it, where you suggested that legislators would not be eligible for health care insurance.
Yeah, nice. Or retirement. All right, and then next week you'll see one on a Viking stadium funding. I'm making all kinds of friends there.
You got friends in here.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thanks, Andrea. And she voted no on the Viking stadium, so I'm proud to have her as my representative. It's amazing to me how much time we spend on the marriage issue when we have a $16.8 trillion budget, our federal debt. I mean, what are we doing here? We're at war over 10 years, and we're talking about the marriage issue. And I think civil unions, personally, is a compromise, but it doesn't seem like the DFL wants any of that. All right, I can recognize when a crowd is hot, when a crowd is crowded. And so I'm going to kick up this meeting and kind of put it to an end. But what I want to do is we have this really cool segment. It's called What's Hot on YouTube? Give me a second here. And what that does is it allows you, if you're not watching YouTube very frequently and didn't get to catch the stuff in its original content, it gives you the ability to see some of the coolest videos out there on the web right now that are trending, that are Tea Party oriented. So I am going to take a break after we're done with our official meeting, give you about 2 or 3 minutes. You can go over to the bar for the after party. Benner's already back there. You can buy him a beer if you want to know more about the Constitution. We'll take about 2-3 minutes, then we'll allow anyone that wants to stay to see the three videos I have. I got a 15-year-old girl that pretty much tells the legislature what it means to believe in gun rights, and I got Ted Cruz versus Dianne Feinstein. So it's really cool videos, but I'll give you that opportunity to leave if you're hot and you need to go somewhere else. But before we adjourn for the evening, what I want to do is bring Jack back up here, and let's go, I mean, open up your iPhone, your BlackBerry or your old physical calendars and get these dates in there. And let's go in chronological order. What do you have first?
Saturday. Saturday we have the State Central Committee. That's important, okay? That's not up there. But if you're in a BPOU and you're a central delegate, check with the people in your BPOU how they are leaning and answer questions before you go and make your votes, okay? Next, May 2nd is the next East Metro event.
Okay.
Oh, we are out of chronological order already. We're missing April 27th, right?
Yep.
The tax rate.
I'll do these. We're not going to do chronological order. Well, first of all, I'm still disappointed. I wanted to use my laser pointer on the pistol I got in my pocket to point to the screen, and he got all upset.
Jack, that's why we have our official East Metro Tea Party laser.
Oh. Let's start with some very big ones. Chris Ann Hall. Who remembers Chris Ann Hall? Okay, we are overran with requests to bring her back. We're bringing her back in a different way. On Friday, June 7th, she's going to be in Rochester with the Rochester Tea Party Patriots down there. Then Saturday, June the 8th, she's back in the Twin City area here for her full seminar. Please get your sheriffs there. Please get your elected officials there. Please get your school teachers there. This is an incredible seminar that she does. It's something else. You don't want to miss it. Then on June 9th, on Sunday afternoon, we take Chris Ann Hall up to Jim Newberger's area up in St. Cloud. So we're going to have her cover the entire state this time when she's here. And I guarantee she'll have something different at each one of those places. You don't want to miss her. She's something else. Then July 27th, this is a fun one. This is Beer and Bullets at the Metro Gun Club. Wow, there's nothing more than mixing beer and bullets in the face of the DFL. They start freaking out. That was the one time last year, one of the press calls up and said, you guys actually drink when you shoot? I said, I always drink when I shoot. He didn't specify alcohol, so I was being honest. So that's gonna be fun. It's something else. Then on April 15th, we have the, what's it? Yes, Patriots Day Rally. April 27th at the Capitol will be the Taxpayers League Rally down there. What is it? Tax Cut Rally. Alrighty, I think that's all I got. And for the North Metro, we are not having a meeting this month because of the tax stuff going downtown and because of the Blue Fox is gone, but we'll be back to the second Thursday of each month in May. Alrighty, here you go. Thank you very much tonight.
Thanks, Jack. Okay, the other two events we have is May 2nd is our next Tea Party event. It will be in a big room. Don't need to put that in the comment box, but other comments are welcomed. I have about 95% confirmation from the newest contributor to Forbes magazine, Kurt Bills. You might remember that name, ran for U.S. Senate. Likely will be at that event, and I've got a couple other invites out there, and you'll find out about that during the month. The other thing that's very important, just a quick show of hands, who knows who Thomas Woods is? That's an issue. Everyone needs to know who Thomas Woods is. Thomas Woods is one of the smartest guys I've ever met on the Constitution in early economic history, or I'm sorry, economic history. He is actually going to be at O'Gara's. It's put on by SD 65, Senate District 65 Republican Party. He is a, I can't say enough good things about this. I am strongly pushing this event, and I will bring that up again in May 2nd, but put that on your calendar, May 4th, at O'Gara's. It's in the big garage, so it's got plenty of room, and I don't have a time. I don't think that's determined yet. Okay, I think that's about it. I had a hand go up. Did you want to add something?
Yeah.
I'll allow it.
Next Tuesday, we have a grassroots meet at North Oaks.
Okay.
Every man and woman invited there. I know Susan's going to be there. Gary's going to be there. It's going to be a great meeting.
What's the grassroots event?
Well, that's all I know. That's
take a risk. Show up.
Grassroots is going to cut the grass on the greens.
Grassroots event.
Yeah, yes.
Okay.
I don't think it's good.
Oh, you don't?
No, I don't know what it is.
Oh, you're going to come with
I've been sent an invite, but I haven't got that far in my calendar.
Oh, I see. Well, they have a good speaker. Good just stuff. Like here.
Well, if you want a good time, go to the event on, what was the date?
Grassroots.
Grassroots on the 9th. There you go. All right.
North Oaks in the 100th Village Center.
There you go.
Is that for Section 8?
Yeah, I know, I love it. Jack, it's been a real pleasure. Like I said, I am going to I got another hand going up. This is the last one we're gonna allow.
I'm following up on okay. His email is
oh, these are the North Metro people, that's the problem.
Give me a sec. Okay.
S J.
YBMSSJ
at AOL.
People still use that, huh? AOL.com. All right. Only North Metro. Okay. The older people. You know, we do. Jack, Nate Waldron, who was a delegate to the National Convention, put your hand up, Nate. And he actually brought the youngest member of the East Metro Tea Party. Two months old? Is that, or 1 month?
1 month.
What, and what's your child's name? Naya Elise, that's great. Well, that's the youngest member of the East Metro Tea Party.
Were you here to hear about the Tea Party experience with your daughters? Oh, did you hear that earlier, the story about having the Tea Party with your daughter? Okay, just write it down, remember.
All right, well, I hope we didn't fall flat on our face tonight. Like I said, we're going to convene in 3 minutes. I'll kick up the YouTube. There's 3 videos. The after party is in the bar. You can buy Dave Benner a beer. He will tell you more about the Constitution. And I guess I'll tell you more about economics for that same going rate.
Thank you, Jake.
Thank you to the organizers, Jack Rogers. Thank you for coming over here. David Benner, Jim Neuberger, our speaker. Thank you, Mary Franson, Andrea Kiefer, and Kathy Lohmer. Thank you for coming.